What is Taiwanese food? Is there even such a thing? After all, the island itself only seems to exist as a series of happy accidents. Chances are that you've probably tasted it somewhere, or anywhere across the world. You might have just confused it with something else. Contrary to popular belief, Taiwanese food is not Thai food. So how do experts and we Taiwanese define our own cuisine?
Taiwanese cuisine is quite subtle in character and it's quite light.
There's a lot of influences over the last 400 years. We could have started from Dutch and Spanish.
It has been recognized as not merely an impoverished subset of Chinese culture.
Then there would be a Japanese influence.
I feel like I always have to gauge how much people know about Taiwan in order to broach the subject of Taiwanese cuisine first. And, you know, oftentimes there's just a little bit of a history lesson.
I myself have a much simpler explanation.
How do you know it's Taiwanese food if there's not a ton of Thai spice?
That's probably an explanation you won't accept, though I can live with that. But so let's take some time to figure out what makes Taiwanese food so Taiwanese-y. In this round, I want to dive deep into an icon built around tiny balls, an invention that probably rivals the other tiny thing that Taiwan is known for.
The one which has spread the widest isn't really a food, but a drink.
My name is Eric Z, raised in Taipei, but stuck in New York ever since I was 18. I have two restaurants here, both Taiwanese. But don't come eat my food if you're expecting the traditional stuff.
We got a one-star Google review. This motherfucker was like, as a born and raised Taiwanese, this is not authentic at all. No one should ever put mayonnaise in your ochunbing.
And that's really too bad, because New York has encouraged me to put my own perspective on Taiwanese food, whether you like it or not. Having said that though, it doesn't mean I'm not interested in finding out more about Taiwanese food and how it came to taste the way it does.
We should definitely try to understand the reasons why some Taiwanese dishes are so well loved across the world.
Singapore has had bubble tea since 1993, and it's still going.
Bubble tea is big business. The industry is estimated to be worth over $4 billion worldwide by the end of 2027. It is enjoyed in over 50 countries and is so popular that McDonald's in Germany started serving it in 2012. But how did bubble tea come about?
Bubble tea is a reflection of the times that invented it, the 1980s, an era of experimentation and full-on hustling.
Legend has it that some tea house owner, either in Tainan, to the south of the island, or Taichung, to the center, started the trend by adding tapioca balls to handshaken tea. We'll never really know who started it. You know, a decade-long legal battle couldn't even determine that. But the important thing is, when Taiwan began exporting it to the rest of the world in the 1990s, it was an instant hit. It's probably one of the few things that everyone unabashedly loves about us. I mean, just saying this, but China alone has over 450,000 bubble tea shops, with some outlets selling nearly 3,000 cups in a single day. So why does everyone love a drink that makes you chew gummy like balls? And more importantly, what makes bubble tea so Taiwanese? And to do that, I'm going to travel to one of the last frontiers that bubble tea has yet to conquer, to get to the start of an impending boba invasion, and see if I can get a sense of what everyone felt during the first conquest of the 1990s. I am headed to Eastern Europe.
Road trip. We just crossed over the border. We're now in Poland. First time in Poland and going to this bubble kingdom. Yeah, let's see what that's all about. But there's gotta be a reason why it's taking over the globe.
I decide to take a detour. Because it is important to learn more about Polish cuisine and food, it may help us understand why bubble tea has a market even here.
We are in Wrocław. I'm gonna look up how to pronounce it first before I make a fool out of myself.
Wrocław.
We are in Wrocław. Interesting. Fourth largest city in Poland. It's crazy how they can just preserve the architecture like this. Oh man, we just sat down at this random Polish restaurant in the middle of the plaza. Looks delicious. Thank you. Oh man. Thank you. Yeah. It seems like it's a slightly elevated Polish food, so not exactly super popular with the locals, but exactly what we're looking for, right? Something about me and pork hock, man. Inseparable. This is a little bit more like a braised than roast. It's not the crispy fried one that we had in Germany. Smoky. Reminiscences of American ham. Culturally appropriate. Oh. Lightly cured. I thought that was mashed potato, but it's horseradish. But even still, it's so good.
But this is not the main course for my time in Poland. I'm here to explore the next conquest of my people's bubble tea invasion. My destination is Kraków, one of the country's oldest cities dating back over 1,000 years. And it's here where I'm about to find a fellow Taiwanese working to further the bubble kingdom.
I love bubble tea. I love to make people happy. I like to make new friends. For me, I'd really like everyone to find the joy, like from me or from the bubble tea I have now. And I've been living in Poland, Krakow, for 3 years already. I was a student. First time, I felt like I don't belong here because like the language barrier and also the food, the culture, and they are not that used to the foreigner. Actually, I mean the Asian looking person. That was a culture shock. But after that, I realized that actually people are interested in the culture from another side of the world.
Oh.
So basically, this is the place with the kitchen. And we'll cook the tapioca, cook the food, and also the tea. So basically everything. And in the morning, we'll just start with the tapioca because it takes a lot of time. Mm-hmm. So that's why we're here an hour before the opening of the shop.
Okay. 上面那些什么机器啊？那些就是
fructose dispenser.
所以这些就比较像是我们备用的，因为你知道，就是在欧洲的话，收东西啊、买东西没有那么容易，所以我们都会先备个好几台，连那个我们的冰沙机也是好几台这样子。很好，我们店里那种切葱的机器也是备了三个。
你是韩国来的，你去韩国等韩国寄回来，然后连这边维修都不用吃葱了吗？对。My favorite part of bubble tea is the tapioca. The texture, the taste, it's just so interesting.
要煮一个小时，你说？对，大约就是一个小时的整个过程。那因为就是，如果煮的不好的话，那客人就会。 有反应，叫
Bubble Kingdom。对
，Bubble
Kingdom 就是他们最想要就是珍珠，因为它慕名而来，你知道吗？就是他们从来没有喝过珍珠奶茶。那波兰其他城市基本上是没有珍珠奶茶可言的，他们就是比较是一些糖浆啊，或是就是那些比较爆珠那种比较传统，就是可能台湾二三十年前的水准这样子。 It's hard to explain to people what tapioca look like. They just have to try it because it's kind of like chewy. It's kind of like bouncing in your mouth when you are biting it, but it tastes so good. It just like perfectly matched with the drink. Like a lot of people were scared of that, but when they tried it, they're addicted to that. So different base of tea, it affects the taste of the drink very much. For example, we use 3 kinds of the black tea and then the milk tea, it tastes with different layers. So it's not just like, oh, you taste the tea. Oh, you taste the milk. But when you taste it, you'll be like, okay, first I feel a little bit of the citrus, and then you feel a little bit of the cinnamon. You will not be bored with just the milk tea. Yeah, you will want to have more.
They're surprised in finding a bubble tea shop in a city like Kiev, because it's 2022. Every city in the world probably has a bubble tea shop. Whether or not open by a Taiwanese person, that's a whole other story. But we are at a place in time where bubble tea has taken over the world. Everybody knows about it. Everybody likes it. It's proven. It's a fact. Nothing really surprising about it. But I do think being in 𙞉𝙞𝙞𝙩 because, I mean, Asian cuisine isn't super prevalent here. And so it's almost like having gone through a through machine, going back to, I don't know, early 2000s New York, where bubble tea had just started being introduced.
Is it really just first mover's advantage? If Bubble Kingdom is reminiscent of the early days of boba world domination, what can it tell us about the drink's ability to attract people? How does something as Taiwanese as bubble tea work, even here in Eastern Europe?
In the Eastern European culture, they don't smile. They don't like to express their feelings to the stranger. But once you get to know them more, basically, when they have the poker face, it just means that they don't know you that well, and they to be more professional. So when you get to know them, they're actually smiling to you all the time because they like to talk to you. So basically, the reason why we make it like really colorful, it's because, like, you know, bubble tea, like, there are a lot of flavors and it's for everyone, like the rainbow. And we want to bring the joy to everyone who came here. They enjoy the drink, they enjoy the atmosphere here, and they enjoyed our service, especially the service, because we learned it from Japan. And you know, everywhere you go in Taiwan, you will get excellent service. Like, people are always smiling, they always trying to help you. Even though you don't know the language, they're still trying to entertain you.
In many ways, most people would say that Taiwanese stuff is pretty cutesy and fun. Not unlike bubble tea, with all its, you know, variety and colors. But why are Taiwanese things fun and perky, though?
With the Japanese colonization for the first part of the 1900s, maybe that the influences from that period, because, you know, Japanese packaging design is very colorful, it's very punchy, it's very playful. Yeah, maybe that just kind of left its mark on Taiwanese design sensibilities.
I think it's really smart for Jen to open up in 𙞉𞞞𞞉𝙞 because there's no competition. Most young folks get kind of stuck in the glamour and the social influence of big cities like Warsaw, Berlin, Paris, New York. And he didn't fall for that, right? And him being a very youngster, introducing the market to something that is already so well established in the world, it gives him so much margin of error.
这个地方是我们之前第三间店，现在又租给一个咖啡厅。对。OK，没关系啊，过几个月就把它干回来。他们了解台湾吗？Like 他们
他们认识台湾吗？
他们对台湾的了解有限。 对啊，他们就觉得说就是一个亚洲的地方。
They just know from the news, like Taiwan has some things with China, some hate, love relationship, but they don't know the culture. Taiwanese people are really friendly, and we are eager to introduce our culture to them.
那你在做蒸奶刚开始的时候，你有需要很多的去教育这边的人说台湾是哪里？
其实不用教育，只是重点是他们对这个很有兴趣。 嗯，对他们就觉得说啊，台湾是 OK，
然后啊，原来蒸奶
是那边，他们以为是美国来的，了解。对，所以就是他们听到之后，反而会更有兴趣，然后更想要去试说我们的奶茶，哦，原来就是这个就是台湾人都是怎么喝的，对，因为会来我们店的客群，通常就不会是其他奶茶店的客群，因为他们习惯这边，就不会去别的地方了。
那你觉得你开了这两年里面，大家对台湾的认知有没有更广泛一点？
我觉得倒是有，第一个是媒体的流动性，第二个是开始比较多人去旅游了，那他们会想要去知道说奶茶，哇哦，这些 K-pop， 他们就觉得很新奇，这奶茶不分国界，对，哪个国家的奶茶，他们就会想知道说哪边的奶茶好喝，那他们就会说台湾。He
believes that represents his culture the most. And so he brings it forward. Yeah, maybe he dialed it up 100%, but at the end of the day, that is his true self. And it shows, because it's been open for 2 years now. It's hard to put up a front when it's that energy consuming, because being that bubbly is very, very energy consuming. But he's been doing it for a long while, so. Nah, I think it's appreciated, because the Taiwanese people are bubbly, are optimistic, are resilient, and are very kind and well-mannered. I think those are the things, the little tidbits that he highlighted.
我们这边的设计其实就是用本店的元素，就是有各种的颜色啊，各种小东西去装饰，去让这个空间没那么小。那现在有计划再开？
再开一间，对，所以我们明年的话会打算再开一个餐厅的，啊，对，又要做饭，对，因为餐厅还是比较稳定一点，尤其是冬天的时候。Moving
from a bubble tea lifestyle shop to a restaurant, that sounds very much like a smart business plan, especially when it seems that locals in Poland have an appetite for Taiwanese things. And this business evolution is not unlike what the early Taiwanese food pioneers did. Now, there's something you should know about Taiwan in the 1980s. It was a time when many Taiwanese people were super into stocks and investments. But then the bubble burst towards the end of the decade, creating a whole lot of problems for a whole lot of people. Well, everything, in my opinion. Because when the bubble, get it, burst in 1990, you had a ton of people broke and out of work. And that is also when street restaurants and small businesses went into hyperdrive. Everyone had that gambling mindset ingrained in their DNA. But this time, they started rolling up their sleeves to get shit done. And the moment they sensed that there was money to be made in adding something on top of something else, like adding a restaurant menu to a drink kiosk, they do it. Seems to me that bubble tea was an innovative product of this hustler's mentality. I mean, legend has it that boba tea started in the old street tea houses before taking on the world. And to prove my hunch, I'm headed back to Taiwan to an establishment created by one of the pioneers behind bubble tea.
This
one has 一有二楼的我餐厅的时候，我们就有在。
它是，所以刚开始的时候什么时候开的？因为我长大的时候没有二楼这边。
对，没有这边，应该是九十 98年左右吧。
98年。
对。
OK。
对。
这就是你们制茶区域。
对，我们制茶区吧台。
全部，所以你所有的饮料都是从这边。
都从那边出来，对。
然后你们这边也是一个餐厅嘛，对不对？
对，其实主要就是把茶跟餐点作为一个融合，让大家能一整天待在这里都没有问题，可以吃饭，可以泡茶，可以吃点心。
那我可以看参观一下厨房吗？
没问题，好，走吧。看一下啊。
好。
从这里好了。
好。
这边是一个出餐。
啊哈。
对，所有的餐点就是在这个厨房制作的。
哇，你厨房很大。
因为我们餐点其实等一下给你看菜单你就知道为什么厨房这么大。
所以你们的餐点是入住百货公司以后才开始？
其实即使门店的茶馆营业时间都通常到凌晨5点，所以一开始会有宵夜，然后延伸到哎好像宵夜的餐点卖得不错，我们就往前延伸，就变成有排餐、牛排、小火锅，慢慢延伸出来之后，哎，老板觉得好像这一套不错哦，大家的接受度蛮好，所以进到百货的时候就马上先以餐为主，然后带茶，茶带餐，带菜茶，不知道，反正就是这样出来的。1986年，民国75年，我们在台南赤崁楼附近有开一间门店，那珍珠奶茶就是在同年1986年的10月。就是十月二十五，除了是台湾光复节之外，也是珍珠奶茶生日。哎，啊，他是在十月在菜市场看到这种小颗珍珠。以前早期的台湾是没有这么大的吸管，所以是小珍珠先出来的。所以为什么它叫珍珠呢？因为它放在杯子里面清澈清楚。那时候也没有所谓的奶茶，最早台湾是泡沫红茶先出来的，所以它是放在清澈茶里面，有放在绿茶里面，放在红茶里面，它就像珍珠一样，所以取名珍珠。
所以你们是以茶馆起家，后来茶有名，后来慢慢在拓店的时候，就把一些餐的部分去掉，在小一点的门市开 grab and go。
对，主要就是说希望能在10坪以内，我们也可能开店；60坪、80坪，我们也能开店。
So I feel like 翰林。Honestly, I was surprised. I was really surprised because growing up, Taiwan is literally littered with these type of concepts. Every corner would be a 茶馆 to go boba shop with some sort of food. So when we walked in, I didn't know what to expect and I wasn't expecting too much. But the conversation with her was really, really thoughtful. And it was truly quite intriguing. Because to me, they have the 茶馆 that's way more expensive to run,way less scalable, but the thing is, the fact that they're insisting on trying to open more tsukumakwans, rather than going just copy and pasting a bunch of to-go concepts, you can tell right then and there that the owner is sort of an artist, right? There is that signature stubborn artistic mentality that is pulling him back from really just going straight commercial. And I kind of enjoy that.
But beyond the art, is there something within the concoction itself that endears bubble tea to the mass market?
为什么偏偏就是珍珠奶茶一炮而红？因为大家是不习惯的。
因为打破了思维，就像你刚刚说的，正常那个年代啊也好，现在也好，觉得喝的东西里面应该不要有，该不要的。那因为打破了这个思维，我其实可能这一杯我就可以饱一餐了。对，所以我觉得珍珠奶茶的文化是在于它有点像饮料，但是有点像甜点，好像又有点带有流行的，所以我觉得是这一块才能一直哦到现在还是哦台湾珍珠奶茶，台湾珍珠奶茶。
因为我们这就是探讨台湾的美食还有文化，我们发现一个很大的共通点，就是大部分具有台湾代表性的象征的东西。都出自于1980年代
哦，真的哦，
珍珠奶茶、盐酥鸡，甚至牛肉面也是那个时候才开始盛行。然后，你如果要讲连鼎泰丰小笼包也是，后来去年也是80年代末。你有你自己的看法吗？
有，但是说出来是不是透露出我的年纪？
不会，因为那时候是
80年代是算是台湾景气关键的时候，所以。有钱的人就有想法了，有想法了就会做了，做了成功了就是出来了。 就是那个时候，其实就连我们茶馆也是，为什么四张桌子生意这么好？他在闲嘛，就想要泡茶去想事情，想要泡茶什么，所以那个时候其实做生意都很好做。我是觉得那个时候的经济特别适合去产生新的东西，因为有钱。
I mean, 翰林 started in the 1980s. Again, pretty classic example. 1980s.Taiwanese economic boom. They were fortunate enough to be part of this bullish market, right? So I was talking to my dad. He benefited from this 1980s, 1990s Taiwanese economic boom. That's how he made a very comfortable living. And he told me that concepts that survived are the ones that kind of adapted throughout time. But what I didn't see, what I don't see today, are the concepts that failed. Not everybody survives. Only the 1% is left. And that's what we see today.You know, I would have loved to witness that myself. That was kind of the golden age of the Taiwanese entrepreneurship. I'm gonna call them hustlers. All these Taiwanese hustlers got that one thing in common. They lived through that time. They have the mentality. I have the idea, I'm just gonna go for it. I'm gonna go try.
The hustler's mentality may have helped create the bubble tea phenomena. Legend has it that a Taiwanese dude first started selling tea made with cocktail shakers in 1949, after working as a mixologist in Japan, of course. Known as 手摇茶, or hand-shaken tea, it's a rich ice blend with foamy air bubbles on top. This is also an essential ingredient in bubble tea. This little myth, probably is too far back in history to investigate, but it's worth picking the brains of today's tea growers. After all,The island has been a major producer of top quality tea since the 17th century. I want to understand the significance of Taiwan's tea culture in shaping the bubble tea. Or even perhaps how bubble tea is shaping the tea business we see today.
像你们的茶是在茶界里面已经是顶级的了。那你现在看说世界那么风靡珍珠奶茶。这种东西你对那个看法是什么
珍珠奶茶它虽然它的茶叶的等级或许不是很好可是它融入了一些珍珠或者是奶类的东西加进去之后它的香气跟风味口感就是完全不一样就会颠覆茶叶的理念就对了
奶茶奶花纹我觉得已经有点带出一点点到下一个阶段了像我在美国喝唯一我愿意喝的手摇饮就是我进去你可以选卷音或者是乌龙，然后他都会说是从哪里来的。那你觉得台湾有没有已经开始这一种这个进化了？
应该也是有，可是它等级一定会稍微比较高。可是再怎么高，它应该也不会去拿
最高等的。等的
对，因为毕竟是手摇饮嘛，一杯它的价值性就这样子。你太过于高，它可能也消费者应该也没有办法，也不想要花这个钱。
你觉得有没有这个趋向？就是可能十年以后，我们看到的珍珠奶茶会不会是10%是这些稍微高端一点的手摇店？
应该会有。对，其实我有看过像这种茶，就是纯茶，它没有添加任何东西，然后下去做成饮料茶，就是很单，就是这样子泡，然后用成手摇杯。可是那一杯单价其实真的不便宜。
To be honest.It doesn't look like Taiwan's tea culture has any direct influences on bubble tea. If anything, I would say that bubble tea is a great way to not waste mediocre tea that cannot be sold to serious drinkers. And don't quote me on this. Here is an expert's perspective.
For bubble tea, you know, the quality of the tea itself isn't very important. And if you get a cup of bubble tea in Taiwan, almost certainly the tea is imported probably from Vietnam or somewhere else in Southeast Asia. The Taiwanese oolong growing industry now is quite dependent on exports and having tea connoisseurs in places like Japan and North America. As to whether...Bubble tea gives people the wrong impression of Taiwan's tea heritage. It probably does, but I mean, I think this is probably true in many countries that, you know, something is more famous than something which perhaps has a great history and a greater legacy.
What I do see, however, is that bubble tea sellers are creating new premiums by using higher quality tea as new offering. Could be the fitter, but at the moment, I still want to dig deeper to why bubble tea is so Taiwanese and how it may evolve. So I'm going to explore the last ingredient of this recipe by heading to a boba factory. Before we get there, however, we should address a serious question. Why the hell would people want to drink something that makes you chew on little balls?
I think that, yeah, it has that, like, wow factor. It has that, like, novelty. There's plenty of things and drinks in Taiwan. You got grass jelly, there's maybe pudding chunks and here and there. I think that it, in Taiwan, it's not that different from, like, a big shaved ice, or maybe even, like, a sundae, where you have maybe some chopped fruit, maybe some red beans, but then also tapioca pearls, because why not? And all these different textures are a huge part of the enjoyment of the meal. It's not a meal, a dessert.
I think perhaps we can thank Starbucks for that, because a lot of people who were used to just drinking really plain tea and coffee, because they've been going to Starbucks, they've got used to drinking drinks with, for want of a better word, solid additives to them.
Even then, is there a secret to the taste of boba that makes it so unique? Perhaps it boils down to the way it's made?
We are at a boba factory in Taiwan. David, 你好。
Hey, 你好。
Nice to meet you. 可以把口罩戴上。
可以。
这样，你们公司是什么时候开的？
我们做这个行业的话，其实差不多可能从我大概3岁的时候，我们家那个时候是卖刨冰的。
哦，是吗？
对，后来以后大概到我念专科的时候啊，然后我爸又开始在做这一行，这一个珍珠粉圆。那我们现在做的这个东西的话，它是算是滚动造粒，我等一下带你去看。
OK， 好，
好吧，它可以从粉一路长大，长成一颗大粉圆。
Feels like a science fiction lab more than a food manufacturer, because I feel like I'm in a zombie movie. You seen a World War Z with Brad Pitt? Exactly like that. 当初盖这个的时候是有请顾问吗？还是怎么样？
有啊。是建筑师盖的、啊，你可以听得出来，就是我也不是本科系的嘛，对不对？所以第一，你就是要请到专业的人；第二，你自己要去上课。
了解。
对，我们是用这个木薯淀粉，tapioca，
tapioca starch，
starch， 然后加上焦糖啊，然后加上水啊，然后拌了以后，它会成为这个珍珠的粉啊。那粉下来了以后呢？啊，我们上面都有自动过筛啊、精简啊，下来了以后呢，它就会进到这个滚筒里面。那我们进到滚筒里面，一直让它滚，它滚长大，慢慢从小珍珠，像这边会先从小珍珠来做。好，我给你看啊，它会先变成小的。啊哈。好。
会是像这样子。
对，它会，我们会先做成小的。小的以后呢，我们就会开始帮它分级，因为你这样看起来是一样大，实际上它也是大大小小差了很多。我们就会把过筛，好，那一样大的我们会放在一起，好，比方说特别小的，我们就让它再长大一次。那差不多可以让它变成大珍珠的，我们就会移到那边去，让它再滚大。
But for me as a Taiwanese who grew up in Taiwan, I'm like conditioned to think of those advertisements where they have a grandpa.Just kind of shaking the boba in that bamboo thing. Because there's an element of like handcrafted boba that really sells. So seeing the advanced machinery and that such a comprehensive technological jump in terms of boba manufacturing, that was a culture shock for me.
I think it's actually needed创新。珍珠这个东西啊，对于台湾人来说太常见、太普遍了哈。刚刚也看到它的制程也很简单啊，粉啊、加水、加一点香点、颜色，就这样子而已啊，对不对？好像大家都会做嘛，对。可是我们自己去外面，实际上吃珍珠奶茶，你在台湾啊，老实讲还是品质都是参差不齐啊。这一家今天煮太硬，明天那一家又煮太软，对不对？可是我们在国外可以吗？根本就不可能有发生这种事。那你要做到这样子的程度的话，你可以看到这种工厂设备投资啊什么，其实都很花钱啊。你看啊，它这个可以让它
煮得很均匀，会有搅拌。
哦，这种机器我可以拿来做卤肉饭吗？
可以，可以。
所以一样的概念，对不对？它是用蒸汽，用蒸汽吗？
那你是卤肉饭的酱吧，对不对？
对
啊，可以。
David's company is one of Taiwan's largest producers of boba, and he ships his goods across the world. This all began from a small street stall his family started when he was just a young kid.
So he mentioned he opened a coffee shop. I don't know if the coffee shop is still there, but the fact is, you can see a lot of that entrepreneurial go, 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 go-getter, hustler mentality of the 1980s in him. Right? His dad started the largest boba factory in Taiwan, right? They sell all over the world, but he still took the time because he loves coffee, so he went to open a coffee shop. And then he's integrating that passion with his main profession.
可是我们最近有一个新产品，
什么？
胶原蛋白珍珠。
是。
所有我们办公室几乎全部都女生嘛，你有看到？每人每天一包。今天如果还在用30年前的那种生产方式啊，对不对？你去看。除了我们以外，其他的粉圆厂几乎都是这一种的。那这种的生产方式，它能不能卖进麦当劳，你就很难推展到白人的圈子，你很难推展到欧洲的圈子里面去。
He's talking about how he can sell to the Korean coffee market. So that's like these small details about David. It really makes me jealous that I wasn't born in the 1980s.
And my question now is, how much can the boba and bubble tea actually reveal?About how we Taiwanese create things.
珍珠这个东西借由奶茶让全世界认识到它，它原本只是一个小配角。配，比方说，你像日本人一开始他们在我们台湾人会觉得，哦，他乱搞，煮饭也加珍珠，拉面也做珍珠，对不对？啊，然后什么流水珍珠这样才用筷子做那个流水线去夹。可是当时我们在想的就是说太好了，为什么？因为珍珠这个东西它本来就是有可能有机会可以入菜，那可以入菜的这种 QQ 的东西很多啊，你像比方说黄瓜，你会用那个什么凉皮呀，对不对？好，就是你本来就已经有类似的应用在里面，那西餐要运用珍珠的话也是有它的机会。
你刚刚讲其实还蛮有趣的，嗯，因为你说珍珠是一个配角，疫情期间台湾最出名的在国际上国际半导体，嗯，半导体缺货导致所有的东西都没有办法做，嗯，那为什么偏偏就是在台湾做的这个东西，虽然它是一个小配角，真的是一个小配角，但是它是一个不可缺少，然后地位是没有办法被动摇的一个配角。
我觉得你刚刚讲的很像我们聊天讲的，就是我们是小岛的生存之道，嗯，好，就是说我们在整个世界的供应链当中啊，我们只是一个小岛啊，那我们能够扮演的角色哈，也没有办法站在第一线当主角了，坦白说啊，那可是我们去做的这个东西，只要我们用心去做，用心去激发它，我们可以把一个小小的东西做得很精致也好，做得很有用也好，做得对各行各业的帮助都有啊。珍珠就是以这样的一个同样的一个思考角度。
They have to use whatever they have and develop from there. This is about job opportunity, isn't it? It's a small island. What job do you do? And then you find little things that you can do to develop. In the end, I think you find things that you can make yourself money. For Taiwan, it just happened to be food and microchips.
Maybe that is the magic with Taiwanese icons like bubble tea.
Love it or hate it, there are many obvious reasons why it is so popular with the world.
It's fun, perky, and colorful. Maybe we took sweet aesthetics instead of the Japanese. At the same time, it comes from a local street innovation like soyao cha and the addition of tapioca balls. It blurs the line between a beverage and a dessert. Some might even call it a meal.It's a culinary tradition also so innately Chinese. Yet there is their deep Taiwanese hustler culture that pushed it to become this global export. One comes from a fact that we are a small island trying to carve a seat for ourselves at the world's table. What we create may look simple, There's so much underneath the hood that you may not suspect. A deep system, very much like a microchip at the heart of everything we do. To test this hypothesis, I'm going to check out another Taiwanese food icon, the popcorn chicken. Another ridiculously simple looking dish that's also, coincidentally, taken the world by storm. My destination is one of the island's first big chains that also grew out of a single street cart. You'd think that it can't be this complicated when it comes to selling fried chicken, no?
从客人一进来的SOV, 他从拿点餐卡, 然后每一个点餐卡的牌子,它都有一个号码, 对,一个号码, 对号码。 以前本来不想做这个展示柜员说我们走麦当劳的模式就模后面那个品项
就是 menu
但是我们的一个消费者你看到 menu 跟看到现有的产品你一定会有看到现有产品一个是看到图一个是看到字大部分人都喜欢看图对看到堆成山就马上口水就会想要买对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对对
好，对不对？你看，他一秒钟，他就跑出来了。哇塞！有没有？他就跑出来了。
这个真的是我以前考试的时候用的那个
考试的原理。那我们从不要影响排队的人潮，影响人家左右邻居的感觉，所以我们去研发第一套系统，就是我们开始研发。好，从一个路边摊到一个国际化的未来式的一个经营里面，我们要的是台湾的传承的传统小吃，可以把它带出去。
And there you go. Systemic world domination is never far from the minds of a Taiwan of a tussler. Ponder that next time you chew on our balls.